Hello, strangers. I've been away for a while, but Donald Trump has brought me out of hiding. That and my pal, Climate Adam. We're here to do two videos, actually. One of which is this one that you're watching right now. And another, which is on Adam's channel.
So that's going to be much more about what we can expect to the extent that we know, you know, how this is going to affect climate policy in America, in the world, how much that's going to mess things up. Trying to make sense of all of this.
But this video, we're going to take stock and react to some of the wild things that he said about climate change, about science, his attitude to fossil fuels, and, you know, generally the state of climate action.
Didn't want to be making these videos, but here we are.
Here we are. So, should we dive in?
I can think of nothing I'd rather do.
Okay, so let's start with Donald Trump's fossil fuel obsession. We know he loves fossil fuels. We know he's got friends in the fossil fuel industry. And in fact, this is what he always calls fossil fuels.
We have more liquid gold, oil and gas. We have more liquid gold than any country in the world.
Liquid gold!
Liquid gold. I guess that's what Trump's campaigns are generally all about, harking back to a bygone era. Quite apart from the climate issues around oil, isn't the economic, clear economic win that it once was.
We will drill, baby, drill.
They love it. Drill, baby, drill. So Trump has talked about opening up new oil extraction, drilling for oil in protected natural reserves, like in the Alaskan Arctic. And quite frankly, this is the opposite of what we need to be doing.
Yeah, for the climate, it's just an absolute no-brainer that this is a disaster. We know that we already have our hands on more coal, oil, and gas than we should ever burn to keep the planet relatively habitable. At the same time, Donald Trump often frames this as like an economic win or as a jobs win. So it's really worth emphasizing that the way the world looks now, the way America looks now, green jobs seriously outnumber fossil fuel jobs. This isn't a win for the climate. It's also not a win for the economy or for jobs.
He's also pretty obsessed with the idea of clean fossil fuels, which, well, I'll let you watch this, but it's pretty nuts.
I'm against destroying our country based on environmental things that are not true. They're just not true. They want to destroy our country. And yet China's building a coal plant every single week. And coal is okay. They actually have methods now where coal becomes clean coal, all right?
There's so much to, to reflect on in this.
And the idea that you can have clean coal is quite clearly, utterly nonsense, because you can't clean coal.
Even if you don't care about climate change at all, which you should, even if you don't care about climate change at all, coal is incredibly dirty. It's absolutely toxic for the people who dig it up, for the people who breathe the smoke in. It is the most dangerous source of energy that we have.
The US is responsible for a lot of historical emissions and a lot of historical fossil fuel consumption. They're the biggest polluter, they're the second biggest greenhouse gas emitter, and the largest oil producer in the world. And the fact that Donald Trump wants to put more energy, quite literally, into producing fossil fuels and using fossil fuels is a really backward step for the whole planet. And I think it's worth saying as well that there is some stuff that's still in motion. There's some things that have been signed into law, some things that are a win-win and will continue to happen. And we did also talk a bit about that in the video over on Adam's channel, so make sure you check that one out. Some things are already going to be protected because they have benefits that go beyond the kind of political rhetoric. So another thing that Donald Trump is famous for is basically being a climate-denier-in-chief, for calling climate change a hoax, for being a denier. So let's watch some of those clips, shall we?
We're fools talking about global warming. They don't call it that anymore. They call it climate change because, you know, some parts of the planet are cooling and warming. It didn't work. So they finally got it right. They call it, they just call it climate change.
This is something that both of us have heard many, many times over the years. To be really clear, Both phrases have been used for a really long time and refer to overlapping but slightly different things. Global warming refers to the warming of the entire globe as an average, which, to be very clear, is something we definitely are still seeing.
Yeah,
and very much so. And when Trump's like, oh, some places are getting cooler, some places are getting warmer, I think my Trump impression is getting better. when he's saying that, that's really not true. Basically, everyone on the planet is seeing a heating trend.
And it wasn't like climate scientists just made this switch because, like he implies, they have some kind of underhand, malicious agenda. It is actually because there was an increasing awareness that the changes that are brought about by that global warming are not just about temperature. It's about things like precipitation. It's about the droughts, the wildfires, the extreme events that we see, the loss of ice, the changes to ecosystems. And climate change sort of encapsulates that a little bit better.
They said, we have 12 years to live, and we're still waiting for the 12 years.
Let's unpick that 12 years thing, shall we? Where does that come from?
So this, I mean, a different form of this has been said many, many times in many, many different contexts. It's almost always the same story, which is climate scientists saying something like, if we want to limit global warming to 1.5 degrees, which we really do, we need emissions to approximately half in the next 12 years. So that's what this 12 years was referring to, but Trump's really riding that wave of misinterpretation to misrepresent what those kinds of time limits mean.
That's not like him at all. And this other thing about sea level rise.
The oceans will rise an eighth of an inch in 355 years. You know?
This is a kind of classic climate denial approach where you use a false statistic or you pick a really hyper-specific time period, you cherry-pick a very specific number to sort of prove your point. Oceans rising an eighth of an inch in 355 years. Like hyper-specific numbers and also really wrong.
Yeah, hyper-specific and hyper-incorrect. Probably is just him making up these numbers from nowhere, because they really don't match the expectations.
We're currently seeing sea level rise of about 1.5 millimetres per year, and we've seen 10 centimetres since 1993. It's really accelerated since the 1990s. At the end of this century, we could be in for 1 metre or 2 metres, somewhere in that region. And then beyond the end of the century, it really, really depends on our actions. And I think the most important thing to say about sea level rise is that our actions today have a really long-term effect. So what we do today matters for many, many, many generations to come. The next clip is him talking about these poor fools, these poor climate scientists who don't know what they're talking about. Let's have a watch.
It's going to global warm to a point where the oceans will rise an eighth of an inch in 355 years. You know, they have no idea what's going to happen. It's weather.
So he kind of threw it in there, but he said it's weather, right?
Yeah.
So I guess we need to do the what's the difference between climate and weather thing, don't we, Ella?
Yes, I think we do. You know, climate is what you expect. Weather is what you get. It's cold out one day. It's warm out the next day. Neither of those are evidence that climate change is or is not happening, actually. It's the trends over the really long term that matter. And the other thing is that, you know, we can predict the weather pretty well. I mean, otherwise, weather apps would be completely useless. Scientists and meteorologists can predict the weather really well in advance and really, really effectively. Otherwise, you know, you wouldn't trust them to tell you whether you should wear a coat or take your umbrella out.
And when climate scientists predict the climate for the future, we're not going out there and saying, on the 11th of November in 2050, it's gonna be, I don't know, 13 degrees and rainy or whatever. Like, obviously we can't do that. And so we're talking much more about the patterns.
Okay, so now we've sort of done some of the horrific climate denial stuff. We know where Donald Trump is coming from when it comes to climate change. And he said a lot that he's going to change the way that the US engages with climate action, both on the national scale and on the international scale. And this is something we speak about in the video over on Adam's channel as well. So I'm just gonna play you this little clip.
If you are elected, will you pull the US out of the Paris Accord on climate change once again?
Well, we're gonna do it again because it's a ripoff. We pay $1 trillion, other countries pay nothing. China pays nothing, India pays nothing, Russia pays nothing, and we pay $1 trillion at least. And we'll take them out so fast your head would spin. It's a ridiculous one-sided deal. All they did with the Paris Accord is take advantage environmentally of the United States, and we're not going to stand for it.
so many, many bits of wrong in there.
It's amazing, like, if it wasn't so depressing, it would actually be impressive how much he manages to cram into such a short space. So the Paris Climate Agreement is an agreement to try and limit global warming, but it's really a pretty weak agreement. Effectively, countries pledge what they're going to do, and then if they don't do that, there's zero consequence. I don't quite understand how you get from there to this is a terrible agreement for the United States.
And the idea that the Paris Agreement costs the US trillions of dollars, I'm not sure where he gets that number from at all. There's a climate fund that has been set up to support climate actions, particularly in the countries most affected by climate change. The bar was set at $100 billion, not trillion, $100 billion, and that has not really been met. The US contributed $3 billion to that fund, which is quite different to trillions of dollars. Like, it's thousands of times different.
It's literally thousands of times. Also, what is very different from reality in that is Trump really sets up the Paris Climate Agreement as if it's the US helping out the rest of the world, which just absolutely isn't the case. Many other countries are doing their bit far more impressively than the US is, either when it comes to their own action within the country or within the context of supporting climate finance.
So we know that America and Trump particularly have been pretty rubbish on climate science, but there's a specific kind of move under Trump to undermine science and scientists especially, particularly at the kind of federal level. And this is because Donald Trump has a real bone to pick with what he calls the deep states.
Demolish the deep state. Obliterate the deep state. Dismantle the deep state.
He's obsessed.
And obviously these kinds of terms, they're often used as racist dog whistles, and definitely that kind of language is used to refer to people working on climate and environmental issues.
One thing that Donald Trump is really keen on is to get rid of federal agencies. So he said, one of the things that is so... I should do my Donald Trump impression.
One of the things that is so bad. So bad.
So one of the things that is so bad for us is the environmental agencies. They make it impossible to do anything. In America, they have federal agencies that look after certain things. And this includes things like, for example, the National Oceanographic and Atmospheric Administration, which runs data sets. It collects scientific information from satellites. It collects lots of information about weather and about climate. And Donald Trump is trying to undermine this because he sees this as a sort of federal bureaucracy. And this is also tied up in this idea of Project 2025. Do you want to say something about that?
I really don't, but I will. So Project 2025 is largely seen as a conservative blueprint for the next presidency, for Trump's next presidency. And it covers a lot of ground, including things like abortion, LGBTQ plus rights. But there's a lot also on the environment. The blueprint refers to climate science as climate alarmism, and in general talks about really rolling back a lot and doing a lot where polluters and people come into conflict of taking a firm stand on the side of polluters. It sort of feels like they're much clearer goals this time round and much clearer approaches to try and achieve those goals. And so a lot of what the last Donald Trump presidency failed to put in place, we might well now see being put in place with quite catastrophic impact.
I don't know if you remember the last time where Donald Trump went on to a weather emergency broadcast showing a forecast for a hurricane which looked like it had been edited with a Sharpie.
Sharpie gate. Sharpie it was referred gate. To in lots of circles. And to emphasize that, you know, like, these things are funny, they're ridiculous, they're anti-science, they cost lives as well. If people don't have accurate information on weather disasters and also on the long-term shifts to our climate so that they can prepare appropriately, that affects people's livelihoods, it affects people's lives.
And this is part of Donald Trump's rejection of expertise, this rejection of the science, and also promoting disinformation or misinformation, despite the fact that he has said this. This is arguably the most terrifying one.
I'm really
if any U.S. university is discovered to have engaged in censorship activities or election interferences in the past, such as flagging social media content for removal of blacklisting, those universities should lose federal research dollars and federal student loan support
for a period of 5 years and maybe more. I will then ban federal money from being used to label domestic speech as mis or disinformation.
I'm going to stop it there. There is so much. Like, the thought that they're going to stop the labeling of mis and disinformation, including labeling something on the likes of Twitter or X, that is wild. And to remove funding from a university or an academic or a civil servant who goes out of their way to tackle mis or disinformation is so alarming. This is, I think, one of the scariest parts for me. That is, under the guise of promoting free speech, actually doing exactly the opposite. It's only free speech if it reinforces what he wants it to reinforce.
It really takes what we saw under the first Donald Trump term to the absolute extreme. So in the first term, we obviously saw a lot of mis and disinformation being spread by Donald Trump and by the people working with him. But now it's being taken to the point where anyone who calls that out is facing really serious consequences. And I think it's really worth emphasizing that it's not just the consequences that are quite concerning, it's also the tone in which this is being spoken about, as if people who are trying to clarify what is real and what's not are in some ways enemies of the state. And that kind of language has a rich history of leading to very troubling actions from governments.
Yeah, so all of this is in the name of kind of stopping censorship. And I think the sort of thing that we do, like talking about climate change on YouTube, I have a suspicion is going to get a hell of a lot worse. So do make sure you're supporting your favourite climate creators if you can, which I hope would include us. All of this is going to affect all of us. A lot of the platforms are US-based. So these sorts of anti-censorship and pro-free speech policies are going to have a profound global impact.
I'd definitely say, watching that last clip, my heart really sinks, thinking about what it could mean in terms of the amount of misinformation that's being spread and that we're effectively competing with, and the kinds of comments we're going to end up getting. And so if you want to do a little bit to counteract that, you know, sharing information from reliable sources, sharing with creators who do present information in reliable ways, what you value about their work, all of these things really mean a lot.
So I think maybe we can summarise by saying there are some pretty scary times ahead. I think, for me at least, I've definitely needed some time to collect my thoughts after the election. I don't know about you.
I feel like my thoughts are still pretty scattered. I'm still kind of trying to pick them up and put them in the basket of my brain.
Absolutely. And I think collectively we do need to take a moment to kind of breathe, grieve, rage, do whatever we have to do, and then pick ourselves up and get together with colleagues and friends to do something about it, because we have to keep fighting, quite frankly. So it's scary, it's exhausting, it's awful, but it's only one part of the picture and we can't look away now. It's not all bad and we've got to look after ourselves, but there are some glimmers of light amongst the dark.
And I think on that note, the video that we've made together on my channel looks at what this kind of speech could actually mean for climate, for the environment, within the US and outside the US. But it also looks at all the things in the world and in America that would be resisting those changes, those glimmers of hope, those signs that climate action might still go ahead in all sorts of different contexts. So definitely check it out.
And also you can head over to Adam's channel to find out why we should be more mangrove. Anyway, that's enough from both of us. Look after yourselves out there. Bye.
Bye.